Good afternoon. Welcome to the first of three presentations, Slavery, Faith, and the Pursuit of Freedom, during which we will be exploring the history of our parish, St. Francis Xavier College Church. My name is Winnie Sullivan, with my friend and fellow parishioner, Lisa Burks. I co-chair the parish anti-racism team, and have been part of the group that has worked to bring these presentations to you today. We have a very compelling one this afternoon, so we are delighted that you are with us, that you joined us today. I'm going to ask Lisa to open our gathering now with a prayer.
Good afternoon. I'm happy to share with you this prayer created for the National Black Catholic Congress with minor adaptations for our gathering here today. O Lord our God, under the shadow of your wings, we have found refuge, strength, and hope. We know that you are with us today, just as you were present with those gone before us, upon whose shoulders we now stand. You were with our ancestors as they journeyed to this land. Their strength they gained from you. You were with past generations who sojourned through tough times and rough places. Their hope they gained from you. Time and again, with an outstretched arm, you delivered them as they clung to you. Their faith they gained from you. Lord, we call upon you to do for us today what you did for others in the past. Lead us, your people, through this new place and time in history. Bless this work of anti-racism. Level the mountains of oppressions we face and make the crooked way straight. Guide our feet to the places you want us to be, and unite us in our struggle, that we may be strengthened in our faith and secure in your promise that the lame shall walk, the blind shall see, the oppressed shall be set free. We ask this in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen.
I'd like to check on before we have a few introductory remarks and introduce our presenters for today. I want to be sure that every person has at their place one of these cards. So we have some extras up here if anybody needs one. Okay. So I would just like to start by mentioning why it is we are making such an effort right now to learn about and understand our history and to share that knowledge. Many of you know that we are currently engaged in a parish racial equity review. That's a year and a half long process that began at the end of last year, and by means of which we are scrutinizing every aspect of our parish life, assessing where within our policies and our practices and our offerings systemic racism is yet being upheld, and acting to dismantle those structures, replacing them with more equitable ones. Aiding us in this process is the Crossroads Anti-Racism and Training Organization, with whom we've been working since 2018. And thus far, that review has included pretty intensive training for those of us who are directly involved, the review team, and that is preparing us then for the next phase of the review, which involves collection of information that we will need in order to make recommendations for change. Now, the very first activity that Crossroads put before us as we started this review was a deep dive into our history to really ground our anti-racism work going forward and to guide the work that we're doing right now. Well, little did we know when we undertook this activity that it was going to be a lifelong adventure. We didn't expect that. But it's been so interesting, and you'll meet the people on the history committee in a little bit. They've just been working so hard. But because our parish is so old, it's almost 200 years old, an understanding of our parish history required us to become familiar with the history of the St. Louis Archdiocese, with the Jesuit order, with the history of St. Louis University, and then our civic history as well, that formed the context for the parish. So all of the important events that were happening in the city of St. Louis, in the state of Missouri, and in our nation. So I invite you to take a look at our historical banners that are over here, and then upon leaving to pick up a copy of our historical brochure to gain a better sense of how these aspects of our history interface with one another. And if you already have a copy of the brochure, let me just say this is the next iteration, because we keep learning new things and have done a little bit of revision. It's our hope that these presentations are going to engage you not just intellectually, but they'll be emotionally resonant as well. And now I'll ask Lisa to introduce what we've found to be a very helpful way to frame what you're going to hear this afternoon.
So through our work with Crossroads, we learn a lot about the power of stories. Stories not only describe people, places, and events, they help us to make meaning of our own experiences. As we look at our personal connection to these stories, we begin to see how they shape our individual and collective identities and guide our actions. And in turn, our actions today create the stories that will be told about us. One of the skills we began to develop in our training involves the process of analyzing stories to see how they function to uphold or to resist racism and other forms of systemic oppression. Based on the work of Dr. Leanne Bell, this model defines four different kinds of stories and their roles in either maintaining or challenging these inequities. We want to briefly describe the types of stories and ask that you keep them in mind as we hear some of the history shared today and throughout the series. The first type of stories are called stock stories, and they present the cultural narrative that is commonly held by the people. They reinforce what is acceptable and considered to be normal. Such stories are created by the dominant social group and passed on through the systems and institutions that they govern. By definition, stock stories are incomplete, misleading, and often false narratives. They leave out not just individual exceptions, but the patterns of exclusion and oppression that can be seen over time. For example, one stock story told about the United States is that everyone has an equal opportunity to achieve financial and social success if he or she just works hard enough. However, that stock story does not include mention of the unequal access to the resources generally needed for that success, such as employment, housing, and education. And these stock stories serve to maintain the racial status quo. The second kind of stories are called concealed stories. They have been left out of our collective history, and they remain largely untold and unheard. Concealed stories are most often told by people in communities of color who have struggled to be fully included in society, or who have been left out or even harmed by the so-called American dream. For example, one example of concealed stories that has recently been coming to light are stories of Native American boarding schools. Contrary to the stock stories that such schools provided opportunity and advantage to Indigenous children, the concealed stories reveal patterns of involuntary separation from family and culture, as well as deprivation and abuse. The omission of these stories from a national narrative allows that practice to continue and to grow. Stories of resistance make up the third category. These stories go beyond the well-known heroes that confront bigotry and injustice in public ways. They recall the many people from all racial groups who have resisted racism and fought against it. For example, while Rosa Parks remains an icon of the Montgomery bus boycott, we are less familiar with the names Claudette Colvin and Mary Louise Smith, who were arrested before Mrs. Parks for similar acts of resistance. Similarly, we don't hear as much about the organized efforts of Black churches, the thousands of Black citizens who marched over a year rather than take segregated buses, or the small but important number of white allies who volunteered to drive people to work. These stories of resistance are important because they give us a more complete and accurate picture of American history and offer models and inspiration. The final story type is called emerging and transforming. We create these stories in the present moment as we build on what we've learned by studying the stock, concealed, and resistance stories. We have a role to play in either supporting or challenging injustice through our everyday actions. These stories interrupt and dismantle the old racist narratives and replace them with new narratives that can redefine our way of being with one another. They build on new perspectives we have gained, and we reimagine what we mean when we talk about building community.
As you listen to and participate in today's presentation, we ask that you try to identify for yourselves these different types of stories. Consider their implications for our anti-racism work today. Listen for the concealed stories and hear the voices of the people whose lives are the substance of which our history is made. Experience an encounter with those people. And as you learn about them, ask yourself, what am I being called to do? Finally, reflect on the emerging and transforming stories. The stories of change that are being written right now. The stories that we are creating together as a faith community.
Before I have the pleasure of introducing today's speakers, we would like to recognize the members of the History Committee who are responsible for researching, curating, and communicating the information you see in the history brochure, or will soon. The information is presented on the banners, in the video that's available online, as well as what is shared with you today. Will members of the History Committee please stand and be recognized? First, Mary White. Father Dan White.
Yes.
Dave Workman, Emory Webre, Winnie Sullivan, and Carl Reiner. We are so grateful to Dr. Kelly Schmidt for her expertise and ongoing support for this project. We want to thank Laura Stanton for her design work that helped to create the brochure and the banners. Many thanks also go out to Laura Winter, a parishioner, for managing the efforts and abilities of this group so that it produced the beautiful materials that will help us continue to share these stories. In addition, we recognize Angela Pancella, whose ongoing support with countless details brings our ideas into being. Also, thanks to the efforts of Mr. Kevin Karam, our media expert, we hope that these sessions will be available online in the coming days, so we definitely appreciate that. And for members of the Social Connections Commission who helped with our luncheon today. So thank you for everyone who supported these efforts. All right, it is now my great pleasure to introduce to you our speakers for today. Dr. Kelly Schmidt is a public historian and digital humanist who specializes in the history of slavery in the United States and how institutions, particularly the Catholic Church, are responding to their historical entanglements with slavery. She has assisted several Catholic institutions, including the Jesuits, the Sisters of Loretto, the Visitation Sisters, the Religious of the Sacred Heart, and the Archdiocese of St. Louis, in addressing their histories of slaveholding. Her forthcoming book tells the history of people enslaved to the Jesuits in the central and southern United States. Kelly previously served as a research coordinator for the Jesuit Slavery, History, Memory, and Reconciliation Project, and is currently a postdoctoral research associate for the WashU and Slavery Project in Washington, at Washington University here in St. Louis. And you'll hear from Kelly in just a moment. I'm also happy to introduce to you, many of us know, Mr. Emory Webre. Being a member of the Anti-Racism History Committee has personal meaning for Emory. Some of his Louisiana ancestors were slaveholders. One of his great-great-grandfathers, whose family helped people in bondage on their plantation in Louisiana, attended Georgetown University in the 1850s. No doubt his attendance there was made possible in part by the 272 enslaved children, women, and men who were sold by the Jesuits in Georgetown in 1838 to pay off his debt. For the past 20 years, Emory has researched history of people enslaved by the Religious of the Sacred Heart in Missouri and Louisiana. He continues to work with the RFCJ's Committee on Slavery, Accountability, and Reconciliation. As a volunteer in the St. Louis Archdiocesan Archives, Emory annotated the records and letters of the first bishops of St. Louis, DeBerg and Rosati, for digital use. He works with the Archdiocesan Forgive Us Our Trespasses project, researching the slaveholding of the bishops and priests and the persons held in bondage.
Okay, I want to share with you about how the Catholic Church here in the area accepted and participated in slavery. And I'll share some stories about the particular family, the Charles Nesbitt family that was mentioned and that a couple of you had at your table. And the challenge is that document that you referred to, the fellow who was reporting referred to, because there are actually four documents about that sale and transfer. The dates are 1822 and 1827, but those aren't dates that tell us exactly the ages of those children, and I'll show you why some of that is there, because there are nine children on the document, and all of those children were not alive at the beginning of the first document and at the end of the second document. So that presents a problem, presents a challenge for interpreting and finding out exactly what was going on with that family And so we'll talk a little bit about them. But most of this family were children who were separated from their parents at a very young age. And so we have to admit and face the fact that the growth of the Catholic Church in the area was enabled and promoted by forced labor of children, men, and women. William Louis Valentine de Burgh, a Sulpician priest, became the first bishop of the Louisianas and the Floridas, which included the area of Louisiana, almost all of the Louisiana Purchase, as well as down to New Orleans and part of what is today Florida. According to one historian, de Burgh, perhaps more than any other missionary priest in North America, was responsible for convincing priests and religious of the necessity of slave labor for the church to carry out its various missions. When he was a child, members of his family in Saint-Domingue, where he was born, had enslaved people, and that's present-day Haiti, Saint-Domingue. And later his brothers in New Orleans had people in bondage. And as a priest in Baltimore, Maryland, de Burgh purchased and sold several enslaved people. Now, Bishop de Burgh purchased an enslaved family, the document says, in 1822. This was not the first enslaved people that he purchased. There was some before, but this family gives you a big picture, an overall picture of how pervasive this was and what happens to the family. So Henry, who was sometimes called Harry, and his wife Jenny, again, she wasn't named in the document. We found out her name later on. And she didn't have a surname. We find out later on that her surname might have been Birch. And their children. Bishop de Burgh initially planned to send his family to the Jesuits, to their new seminary in Florissant, Missouri. But he quickly changed his mind and instead sent them to the newly found Vincentian Seminary in Perryville, Missouri. He regularly took members of this family and either sold them or gave them or sent them to other places, other parishes, or religious communities. Bishop Burgh left St. Louis in 1826, went back to France, where he was originally from, and then resigned his position there, and then began negotiations with Bishop Rosati to make the transition for what he was responsible for in terms of property, authority as the Bishop of St. Louis and New Orleans area, and particularly these enslaved people. Those negotiations went on from 1826, and the last docs we have when they were finally concluded the negotiations was 1830. So a period of 4 years where there was back and forth between Rosati, his lawyers, his priest representatives, and Bishop de Burgh to settle the situation of this enslaved family. The next year, Bishop de Burgh sold Henry and the new Bishop of St. Louis, Vincentian Joseph Rosati, who continued this practice of selling and renting members of the family as he saw fit. So, first of all, Henry and Jenny's oldest son was named Charles. Is there one before that? No, okay, we're going to that one then. So Charles married a woman named Araminta, also known as Minty. She too was enslaved at the seminary. The St. Louis bishops, like other enslaved, made money by renting out the labor of people like Charles. In 1837, while rented in St. Louis, Charles was told he would have to continue working longer than what his agreed upon contract was. And he reacted to this mistreatment by running away. But he was soon captured and put in jail and then returned to his enslaver. Now the laws did give enslaved people the right to sue for their freedom under certain circumstances. Now Charles filed such a suit, as those of you who had him at the table and also Aspasia, filed suit to win their freedom. Rosati was out of the country at the time. He was sent to Haiti to take care of some church business there by the Pope. So the Charles refiled his suit against the Jesuit priest Father Verhagen, who Rosati had left in charge of the diocese while he was away. And numerous court documents in the freedom suits that are available, if you ever want to look into those things, on the Washington University website, provide details about all the different court appearances regarding the search for their freedom. The jury did decide in favor of Charles, but we don't know that what happened to him and whether or not he really actually gained his freedom. Now, Henry and Jenny's second daughter was Eliza, and this is her picture here. She was often called Liza. She was taken from her parents and family when she was about 12 years old. And Bishop de Burgh gave her to Mother Philippine Duchenne, who was a religious of the Sacred Heart, who is now recognized as a canonized saint. Members of the Society of Sacred Heart then inflicted more pain upon Eliza and her family by sending her to their school in Convent, Louisiana, which is just northwest of New Orleans. And Eliza endured the separation not only from her family, her mother and her siblings, but also from several of her own children later on when they were sold or traded, or in the case of a daughter named Elizabeth, who was sent to the Religious of the Sacred Heart School in Grand Coteau, Louisiana, which is in southwest Louisiana. Eliza had dictated a letter later on in her life, and you can read that letter online, at the end of her life, and in this letter, she refers to how much she has suffered, how many thorns the Lord has put on the briar bush, so that God is even tired of afflicting poor old Liza. She wrote that God had laid a heavy burden on her. Eliza spent most of her life serving the sisters and the students of St. Michael's in Convent, Louisiana, until her death in 1889. Insisting on being buried with the sisters, and the superior agreed to this wish, she was placed in the same cemetery with the sisters rather than in a cemetery where enslaved people might have been buried. Later on, in the early 1920s, when the property was sold and the cemetery was removed from the area, her remains were also removed and placed in a tomb with the remains of the sisters. And more information about Eliza's relationship with the RSCJs can be found on their websites and their archives. Eliza was one of more than 150 children and adults that the Religious of the Sacred Heart held in bondage in their schools in Missouri and Louisiana. The Sisters of Charity, also who we know some of you as the Daughters of Charity, held enslaved people in bondage and rented others who worked in the Melanthe Hospital in the early days of St. Louis. And also the Sisters of Loretta held people in slavery in St. Genevieve and in Perryville. Now, Henry and Jenny's second son, Clement, married a woman named Emily Louise, who was also enslaved at the Vincentianist Seminary. And there was a letter between the Vincentians describing Clement as unwilling to be separated from his wife and child. And Clement's refusal to be sold ultimately led the Vincentians to allow him to remain at the seminary. And this is an example of how enslaved people might rebel against being held and forced to work for other people. Clement's effort to avoid sale and keep his family intact didn't last, however. In 1842, the Vincentians at the seminary sold Clement and his family to Jean-Marie Odin, who was recently ordained the first bishop of Galveston, Texas, to provide household help for the bishop. So Clement and his family were first sent to New Orleans, then shipped by steamboat to Galveston, Texas. One tax assessor for the personal property of Bishop Odin in Galveston was for Negroes valued at $900. Clement later on, after freedom, worked as a cook and also owned property, even taking boarders into his home. And then he later served as a janitor in the city office of the mayor and the police of Galveston, Texas. He lived to the age of 92 and his wife to 96. Another daughter of Henry and Jenny was Sarah Ann. At the age of 13, she was sold by Bishop Rosati to a priest in Louisiana for $300. She made money by being rented, one receipt showing that the bishop had received wages of $20 for her work. After the Civil War, Sarah's application for a loan from the Freedmen Bank in New Orleans indicated that she was employed as a washer and living with her siblings. A son of Henry and Jenny was Peter Augustine, who sang in the St. Louis choir when he was about 9 years old, and being described as a fine tenor. When he was 11 years old, the bishop sold him to a priest for $150. He married Helen Leona, an enslaved woman who was later purchased by the seminary in order to bring the family together. One son of Henry and Jenny, Andrew, he was born after Bishop Duberg had purchased the family, and he was baptized at St. Ferdinand in 1823. Between 1831 and 1833, there were competing bids for Andrew between a priest at St. Michael Church in Kinman, Louisiana, and the first bishop of New Orleans, Bishop de Necker. They couldn't agree on the price, and so in order to end that dispute, the Bishop Rosati just held off on selling him. Instead, he was sold to the second bishop of New Orleans, Bishop Antoine Blanc. He had been the bishop in Galveston and then had been moved to New Orleans. Blanc left Andrew in St. Louis instead of bringing him down to New Orleans. And then he was told that Andrew would be at his disposition until the boy became 30 years of age. Instead, Andrew was sent to Natchitoches in North Louisiana, where the priest wrote to Bishop Blanc saying that I'm using every means I can to cure his propensity for stealing and lying. We don't know what those every means were. 4 years later, Andrew was sent to a priest in South Louisiana where he was taught the Catholic Catechism And then he became an apprentice, learning a trade which would enable him to be rented out and earn money. Henry and Jenny were also parents to two of their children who were born after the birth had sold the family to Bishop Rosati. One of these two children was a daughter named Elizabeth, who was born at the Vincentian Seminary, and then as a child, she was taken to St. Vincent's College in Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Later, she was sold to a farmer there named Peter Byrne, and then she married Charles Lee, who was a bondsman of another man. One of their sons recounted the events of Elizabeth's life in the Missouri slave narratives. He stated that in 1837, their enslaver had bought his mother from the Catholic priest. One witness in the church record to Elizabeth's marriage was Juliana, the half-sister, the daughter of Henry and his second wife, Mary, also called Minty, an enslaved worker at the seminary. Henry, Mary, and their daughter, Juliana, had been moved to St. Vincent's College in Cape Girardeau to serve the laborers there. Juliana was listed as a servant of the Catholic College of St. Vincent when she married in 1848. And those of you who had looked at cards that said this person was a servant who had been baptized or married, that was the name that was most often used. Instead of saying somebody was a slave or enslaved, they would call them servants. What we see in the lives of this family, and whose stories I have shared with you, was so often disrupted and suddenly separated without any consultation or agreement on their part. And this was done by the bishops, the priests, and the religious who were responsible for guiding and educating Catholics in charity and justice. Thank you.
So Emory just shared with you stories about the Nesbitt family enslaved to the bishops and men and women religious in the Archdiocese of St. Louis. And now I'm going to focus on the story of some of the enslaved and freed Black Catholics who shaped College Church and St. Louis University. Thomas and Molly Brown, the Tyler family, and the Chauvin family, who we've learned about today, all knew one another. Several were even related. Matilda Tyler, for instance, was Henrietta Mills Chauvin's aunt. Most of each family was enslaved to the Jesuits laboring at St. Louis University and at College Church. And their stories have become hidden and forgotten in our parish history and have only just begun to be more fully uncovered in the last 5 years. Molly Brown had been born into enslavement to the Jesuits in Maryland. In May 1823, when she was about 43 years old, Molly and her husband Thomas were forced, along with two other couples, Moses and Nancy Queen, and Isaac and Susan Hawkins, away from family and kin at the Jesuits' White Marsh Plantation in Maryland to make a dangerous journey by foot and flatboat as the enslaved cargo of a band of 12 Jesuits to establish a new Jesuit mission in Florissant, Missouri, soon known as St. Stanislaus Seminary and Farm. After their arrival, their enslaved community grew through births, children, and through the Jesuits' acquisition of more enslaved people. In 1829, they were joined by 16 to 20 more people, the families of Jack and Sally Queen and Proteus and Annie Hawkins, who were forced to St. Stanislaus from White Marsh. The same year, the Jesuits forced Jack and Sally Queen and Proteus and Annie Hawkins' families from Maryland. The order also took over administration of St. Louis University from the diocese. When they did so, they transferred several enslaved people from St. Stanislaus Seminary to the college, then located downtown near where the convention center stands today. These included Thomas and Molly Brown, Proteus and Annie's son Ned, and two of his sisters. And we don't know yet exactly which sisters, but it's likely they were Matilda Hawkins and Elizabeth Hawkins. Thomas Brown purchased goods for the college and was assigned to supervise enslaved laborers rented by the college. Ned was the college's cook, while his sisters did the laundry. Molly may have aided with laundering and cleaning. Other enslaved people were transferred back and forth the 18 miles between the seminary and the college based on where the Jesuits perceived their labor was needed. Their work consisted of farming the college farm north of the city, doing laundry, cooking, cleaning rooms, running errands for the Jesuit faculty and students, wagon driving, and acting as couriers between the seminary and college. As they did this labor against their will, they were subject to beatings and other forms of brutality. The Jesuits also considered it their obligation to teach enslaved people the Catholic faith, which they did haphazardly and sometimes disinterestedly. They often used this obligation of catechesis to justify holding people in slavery. With few surviving records from the perspectives of enslaved people, it's difficult to know with any certainty to what extent people in bondage embraced Catholicism or had it forced upon them. Records indicate, however, that catechesis and baptism were imposed on the earliest groups of people enslaved by the Jesuits in Maryland, and that over generations, these enslaved families came to make Catholicism their own by incorporating their own ancestral belief systems into their Catholic practice. Those whom the Jesuits forced from Maryland to Missouri showed just devotion to their Catholic faith and even used religion as a means to fight against their enslavement to the Jesuits. Thomas Brown used his religious devotion as a justification to appeal for his freedom. He wrote a petition to Jesuit leadership in Maryland complaining in 1833 about the abysmal housing conditions St. Louis University President Peter Verhagen had supplied him and Molly. He said, "We live at present in a rotten log house so old and decayed that at every blast of wind we are afraid for our lives. Father Verhagen wants me and my wife to live in the loft of one of the outhouses where there is no fireplace nor any way to warm us during the winter, and your reverence knows it is cold enough here. I have not a doubt but cold will kill both me and my wife here." Brown cited the couple's long service to the Jesuits, writing, "I have been a faithful servant in the society going on 38 years, and my wife Molly has been born and raised in the society. She is now about 53 years of age." Brown offered to purchase his and Molly's freedom for $100, which he said was as much as our old bones are worth. We have not yet found evidence of what happened to Thomas Brown, but it doesn't appear he managed to obtain his freedom. Molly Brown certainly did not. She was assigned to labor for St. Francis Xavier College Church until in 1846 she was transferred back to Florissant to serve Father Van Ash, pastor at St. Ferdinand Parish. She died at St. Stanislaus Seminary, still enslaved, in 1852. The Jesuits simply recorded, "Mary, a slave, died piously. Rest in peace." Initially, people of African descent, enslaved and free, were permitted to worship with white parishioners in any Catholic church in St. Louis, albeit often segregated to the back of the church or in a separate gallery. Over time, Catholic worship spaces grew increasingly segregated. Black Catholics in downtown St. Louis primarily attended the old Cathedral of St. Louis, where they joined services from the back gallery overlooking the church. But shortly after the Jesuits took over St. Louis College, Jesuits collaborated with diocesan clergy to institute St. Mary's Chapel, an offshoot of the old cathedral established in a house that had been the first site of St. Louis College and intended for Black Catholic worship and catechesis. People held in slavery by the Jesuits at St. Louis University likely attended services at St. Mary's until St. Francis Xavier College Church was erected on the university's new downtown campus beginning in 1840, after which they worshiped standing or sitting in the back of the church. Several enslaved and free Black Catholics were reported to have recoiled from the embarrassment of sitting in segregated pews and galleries. The Jesuits' dedication to ministry toward people of color was consistently reluctant and halting, and always secondary to their priorities to minister to white St. Louisans and act as missionaries to Native Americans. In 1855, a Jesuit scholastic was made responsible for catechizing black St. Louisans, the first such position since the Jesuits had taken over the college in 1829. In 1858, the university's consultors and trustees discussed whether a Sunday school for the Negro slaves should be begun. In deliberating over this, the board deemed it prudent that this effort not commence without the archbishop's consent. When a member then insisted on catechesis for enslaved people, three of the consultors favored the decision, but the fourth insisted that our burdens are already enough. Nevertheless, in 1858, Jesuit Peter William Koning advocated for the establishment of a separate chapel for black worshipers in a small, narrow gallery up a steep set of stairs at College Church, with a Jesuit assigned to minister to them. Although the university's consultors and trustees had been reluctant to catechize enslaved people, the university's Jesuits argued for this segregation, reasoning that although, quote, the bondspeople's condition is generally not hard and is better than in other parts of this region, and although access to any Catholic church is open to them, they could not adapt instruction in the doctrines of the faith and morals enough for enslaved people, and, quote, the distinction between slaves and masters was so great that bond people themselves desired the separation. The Jesuits were proud of the outcome, for they proclaimed, "It is wonderful how many faithful are strengthened in the faith, how many heterodox are brought back to the fold of the church, nor are they not fervent as they advance in virtue." In their separate chapel, black congregants discovered that perhaps paradoxically, Jesuit ministry became more formalized even as white Catholics came to view black instruction and worship as something that should be separate from their own. Despite the hardships they endured, the families enslaved to the Jesuits at SLU and College Church created meaning in their lives through family, art, and faith. Whatever the confines of their new segregated chapel, the congregants made it their own as they attended services and catechism, were baptized, and were married. One historical record speaks of a boy enslaved to the Jesuits who was the chapel's organist, described as of remarkable musical talent, who composed music for the colored choir and was as proud of its performances as the leader of the orchestra and the boy choir in the gallery beneath the colored people's chapel. Matilda Hawkins Tyler, the daughter of Proteus and Annie Hawkins, who had been forced from Maryland to Missouri in 1829, was one of the many enslaved parishioners who used this chapel. Matilda and her husband, George Tyler, had eight children together, five of whom lived to adulthood. Their four youngest children, Samuel, Anna, Charles, and Georgia, were baptized at College Church between 1840 and 1850. The first records we ever found about Matilda Tyler and her family were the St. Louis University's Board of Trustees' decision to emancipate her sons, George Jr., Samuel, Thomas, and Edmund in 1859, along with the corresponding deeds of emancipation for each son. From these records alone, some people inferred that the Jesuits had freed the brothers out of a sense of benevolence, or a growing understanding of the immorality of slavery as tensions leading to the Civil War grew. These interpretations, which became the assumed narrative, gave all agency in the Tyler's emancipation to the Jesuits and assumed their goodwill. But the discovery of new records revealed a much more truthful version of events. We found in the Jesuits' financial ledgers an entry showing that Matilda Tyler became free in 1848. But the record showed it was not an act of Jesuit benevolence that freed her. Rather, the Jesuits charged Matilda Tyler money for the freedom that should have always been hers. It was Matilda Tyler's own courage, strength, and perseverance, and her persistent negotiation with the Jesuits that enabled her and her children to become free. Due to her insistence in 1847, the Jesuits agreed, "She is to have her freedom if she pays $300 to be appropriated to St. Francis Xavier Church." That $300, which Matilda Tyler managed to finish paying over a year later, equated equates to more than $11,000 today that she had to earn at any time she could spare when she wasn't already working for the Jesuits, which often meant not sleeping at night. 1 year after Matilda Tyler's purchase price of $300 granted freedom to herself and her youngest son, Charles, Matilda walked into the very same church that profited from her bondage and chose to receive the sacrament of confirmation. Her detestation of her family's enslavement to the Jesuits did not dampen her religious faith, nor did her faith deter her from continuing to push for her freedom, for her family's freedom. By 1859, Matilda had succeeded at working with her sons, George Jr., Samuel, Thomas, and Edmund, to earn enough money to purchase their freedom from St. Louis University. As shown here, SLU's Board of Trustees signed off on this arrangement, thus emancipating the boys that year. But Matilda continued making payments for their freedom long after slavery was abolished in 1865. Another woman who appears in the records of College Church is Henrietta Mills, who is referred to in her 1860 record of marriage to Charles Chauvin as a, quote, slave of St. Louis University. Henrietta and Charles had two children born into slavery at SLU, Sylvester and William Francis. After Charles returned from his service fighting for the freedom of all enslaved people in the Civil War, the couple had eight more children together in freedom. The youngest was baptized Louis Ignatius Chauvin and became a famous ragtime musician, composing Heliotrope Bouquet with Scott Joplin and performing in the 1904 St. Louis World's Fair with Sam Patterson. Not until slavery had been abolished did the consultors and trustees of St. Louis University renew discussion of providing a religious institution dedicated solely for people of color. Eventually, the so-called Colored Chapel in Schultz College Church, its membership having outgrown the small gallery, became St. Elizabeth Parish. Father Ignatius Hankin, who had worked with the black Catholic population, helped found the church in May 1873. Hankin is the one our histories have remembered, but it was formerly enslaved Catholics who ushered the parish, who ushered the parish into existence, seeking a place where they could worship free from prejudice. The profits of black labor, including people who were formerly enslaved to the Jesuits, brought the first black Catholic church in St. Louis to fruition. St. Louis University financial ledgers show that Matilda Tyler and her sons paid installments that went to funding first the segregated chapel in College Church and later the construction of St. Elizabeth. At St. Elizabeth, sacramental records no longer marked a person's color or status. Through St. Elizabeth Parish, families formerly enslaved to the Jesuits and other members of the Catholic Church worked together in community to support one another. In freedom, the parish community members drew newly free kin to them in the city as they migrated away from the Jesuit plantation in Florissant. Matilda Tyler's son, Charles, became a civic leader who advocated for the political, economic, and social equality of black Americans. He was nominated unanimously by his peers to run for city marshal, advanced local politics from his saloon, co-founded the first black baseball team, and also co-founded an organization to fund the migration of black people out of the Deep South to places where they could more safely live and work freer of the dangers of racial prejudice. Charles Tyler further worked to support his cousins Sylvester, Peter, Abraham Lincoln, and Louis Chauvin in their careers as baseball stars and ragtime musicians. Both out of coercion and of their own volition, the early black members of our church did much to shape our church, our community, our diocese, our city, and our nation. I hope that we can begin together to restore their stories to our collective memories and our parish history, and acknowledge and honor the contributions they made both freely and without their consent. Thank you.
We know that we're running a little bit over this afternoon, but wanted to afford a few minutes for questions that you might have. So we'll spend a little time right now for for some Q&A. Yes, see a hand. Uh-huh. Okay, we probably need to get a mic to you.
Well, one of the reasons there is so much information is that even when Bishop Rosati was here in the 1830s, he was given some material, and the person who was given to him said, maybe you want to keep this for your archives. And so we have these records. Bishop Rosati in his files has over 2,500 letters received from priests and religious lay people, and letters that he wrote. And of course, the Jesuit archives, the Jesuit tradition of saving material goes back hundreds and hundreds of years, not just recently here in this country, but also in Europe too, where there is so much detailed archive, particularly letters and financial records that we use today to do this research.
Rarely, when you comb through these archives, do you find a box or collection that's labeled African Americans or slavery, because slavery was so pervasive to everything these religious orders were doing, and they didn't deem enslaved people as worthy of note other than for their financial value and for their catechesis. And so the places where we found the most information are in Catholic sacramental records, which are so unique in researching the history of slavery because those aren't kept for other enslaved communities. So that helped us reconstruct some of the families that you've learned about today, and we can compare those with combing for hours and hours and hours through lines of financial records until we find mentions of some of the people you learned about today. So it takes really diligent patient research and a supportive team, and we have some of our team members in the audience, and I just want to express gratitude to them for all their help.
I just wanted to make that observation.
The other thing about the records in these files is that they're all written from mostly a white person's point of view and white society point of view. But if you have a chance to read the slave narratives, which are from most of the southern slaves and states, and those are online, then you'll see more from a black perspective and an enslaved person's perspective what happened during their lifetime.
Yeah, those are available through the Library of Congress. So, yeah, it's really interesting reading. Mm-hmm. Another question?
I found it interesting in some of the papers that we were looking at during our discussion that although the Jesuits wanted them to be baptized and teach them about religion, most of them could not read or write. And so there's a community that founded a university and has supported education but did not educate their slaves.
Mm-hmm.
Will this historical process always, as it is now, from 1800 to now, in terms of racism, it includes the issue of systemic racism?
Absolutely. That's part of why we're exploring this history, because, that needs to be thoroughly examined, and we are just doing this deep dive because we need to keep that history before us. You know, this history is part of the water in which we swim. It's the air that we breathe. And so as we look to make changes, we have to be continually cognizant of that. Yes.
Yeah, I was hoping if Dr. Schmidt would be willing to talk a little bit more about her work in your book.
Sure, I wasn't ready for that question. So I just completed my PhD at Loyola University Chicago a few years ago, and my dissertation was on the lives and experiences of people enslaved to the Jesuits in the central and southern United States. And now I'm working on turning that into a book. So it tells the stories of enslaved people here in St. Louis and also in Kentucky, Louisiana, Kansas, Illinois, and Alabama. And it walks through their experiences of being forced away from their families to labor in all these parts of the country, what their lives were like laboring for the Jesuits, and how they were able to resist their enslavement by building strong faith communities that carried them through from slavery and helped support one another into freedom. So that book is, publication date is forthcoming, but I'll make sure that is, you all get to hear about it when it's available.
Yes, we have some additional questions. Can we get a microphone over here, please?
I just wanted to ask you, in all of your research, did you ever find any evidence of dissenting voices within the Jesuits? You know, I know we have the abolitionists in New England. Were there any Jesuits who, you know, connected the dots and said, stop this?
I didn't hear more about that.
Winnie made a note as I walked by that we're going to hear more about that at the next presentation. So please come to the next presentation. But, there were very few Jesuits who did have anti-slavery sentiments and occasionally may have spoken out against slavery. Most never would have called themselves abolitionists, though, because abolitionists were associated with being Protestant and anti-Catholic. But there are a few, including Father Francis Wininger, who witnessed, in his experience, he witnessed a slave auction and was so moved by that he made it one of his priorities to focus on missionary work to Black Catholic populations in this region and in Ohio and other places. So Wininger and a few others who you'll hear about next time did begin to realize slavery was wrong and do something about it. But for the most part, especially during the Civil War, Jesuit leadership advised the Jesuits to adhere to the regional sentiments that they were part of. So in the central and southern United States, most Jesuits kept quiet about the issue and continued to support slavery, at least vocally.
Okay, maybe just one more question.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Let's see, can I get a microphone over there?
I want to thank all of you who worked so hard to present all this difficult, painful, but important information to us. I am a graduate of the School of Grand Child. My family benefited directly from having enslaved people and from those associations with religious and sacred heart. My understanding is that
Yeah, like in introduction, I've been working with the archives and the religious sacred part for about 20 years now when I first published materials from Louisiana, down in Louisiana, and the archives, the national archives are here in St. Louis. And they're presently working on putting the finishing touches on the history of their involvement in slavery. That's going to be online in the, some of it is already on the RSCJ website. If you go to their archives and look at our history, you'll see more details about that. And that's, you know, accurate with what you were saying about her wanting to become a religious. And there were other instances of questions about colored sisters, persons, wanting to join their community, but were refused because they felt often at the time that if they did, then they would lose the white people who were coming there and who provided all the funds and the money for the support of the schools and the institutions.
So I formerly served as research coordinator for the Jesuit Slavery History, Memory, and Reconciliation Project, and when I was researching the history of enslavement for the Jesuits, I also took note of the Jesuits' treatment of indigenous people. And in Florissant, the Jesuits had a boarding school for Native American boys, and the records show that the boys were treated just as poorly as the enslaved people and often made to work for and alongside the enslaved people on the property. So much, and they experienced so much brutality and beatings that many of the boys ran away or were withdrawn by their fathers. And that's just one story of many boarding school experiences across the United States. And I know that when I was wrapping up my position, the Jesuits were hiring a position like mine to begin doing that research. Father Jeff Harrison, who I'm going to single out, who's over, I can't see him behind the pillar, but he's carrying on the Jesuits Slavery History, Memory, and Reconciliation Project work, and he might be able to tell you more about that. Sorry to put you on the spot, Jeff.
We'll conclude our afternoon now. I want to say a final thank you to our presenters today, Dr. Kelly Schmidt, Emory Webre. You know, the other day I was talking with a person on the history committee and just remarking about how different it is to read these descriptions in a history book, how different it is to hold these original documents and then to really learn about the lives and the experiences of Thomas and Molly, Spazio LaPonte, the Chauvin, Matilda, Charles. And so I want to thank the two of you for bringing us that really profound understanding today. And I thank all of you for joining us. We'll be gathering here again, as Kelly mentioned, next month on October the 16th. And we'll be picking up then kind of where things left off today. We'll be talking a lot about St. Elizabeth Parish, and we'll be talking about some Jesuit voices that were voices of resistance. And so we have that to look forward to. We'll be looking at Jesuit ministry to the African-American Catholic community from about 1858 to the early 1940s. So we look forward to seeing you all then, and thanks again for being with us today. And remember to get a brochure on your way out.